Moving on, the Greenbelt Zone legislation gains ground in Congress. The measure aims to establish a national Greenbelt program to shield fishers and coastal communities from storm surges and the worsening impacts of climate change. For more on this, we are joined by House Committee on Climate Change Chairperson, Congressman Edgar Chato. Congressman Chato, thank you so much for joining for the program, and good afternoon to you.
Hi, Rika. Thank you very much for having me here.
Our pleasure. Congressman, can we first define the term Coastal Greenbelt Zone? What is it about?
Well, our Coastal Greenbelt Zone covers the area, the coastal community, a strip of natural and planted vegetation, about sea towards land, primarily of mangrove and beach forest species, which are designated and coastal erosion, the adverse impacts of natural coastal hazard on lives and property.
The country has a 36,000 kilometer coastal area. We've seen this being looked at now because of the ASIN law, but also because of your bill. Are we looking at a specific area, or is this an all-encompassing kind of a bill?
There's going to be designated areas for coastal in the implementation of it, very coordination, our national and the local government.
We have back on the line Congressman Edgar Chato, the chairperson of the House Committee on Climate Change. Congressman, thank you again for joining us. I'm sorry about this.
Sorry for the signals, Rika.
It's okay. Congressman, we have to go back to some questions that we mentioned earlier. First, let's talk about the protection that this bill can give to the people who live and those livelihood or work is in the coastal areas. What can this give for them?
Yes, I mentioned earlier, Rika, that this is so important because, number one, it enriches also the biodiversity of the area, which basically is a source of food and resources for the community. And even in the production of fish, the mangroves and the areas that are natural forests enhances biodiversity. Other than that, it is also a protection to the safety of the coastal area, as these are buffer zones of very strong waves, storm surges, and other threats to the communities living in the area. And on the area of climate change as well, which is the committee that I chair, it is given a priority because these are carbon sink areas like forests and a big ocean that should also complement with mitigation efforts in the reduction of global warming. So these have very varied impacts that will really help communities.
You mentioned very, very good ideas on particularly three: disaster preparedness, marine conservation, and climate change. Can we break it down a little on those three, Congressman? Let's start with disaster preparedness. What is this bill looking at in terms of enhancing disaster preparedness of those living in coastal areas?
Well, basically, making sure that the communities are ready for things that cannot be avoided. We're trying to mitigate things, but when the circumstances really come in, our country is most vulnerable. We are considered one of the top nations in the world that are threatened by the effects of climate change. So we have to start strengthening our strategies also for adaptation measures. And there are agencies that have to consolidate efforts to strengthen preparedness of our people. But on the coastal areas, they are even more vulnerable. And this happened already in the past, typhoons that happened in the past, and lessons have also been learned that even in Siargao, a community was saved because of a huge mangrove area. I am proud also to say that even in the province of Bohol, we have really started, planting several years ago mangroves in the entire coastal communities that have been threatened by climate change or the effects of climate change. So the components of disaster response ranges from the type of disasters that affect inland and also coastal areas. So we look also into the coastal green belt together with coastal management, resource management, by looking at the pattern of what we call from reach to reef. So the issues must be able to address preparedness, not only in the coastal communities, but also the link of the ecosystem that includes the upland areas. What happens in the upland areas, flash floods and landslides and all those stuff affects also the lowland community. So it has to be holistic in approach, Rica, especially when we talk about preparedness. And the local governments will have a very important role to play because they're the ones that will be issuing permits for buildings, development of zones. All this should be incorporated in what we call the comprehensive land use plan. So our efforts to conserve and preserve the environment and also to prepare for whatever disasters that will be coming in, especially in most vulnerable areas, must consider already the scientific basis for approving permits, for designing communities and where to build them. There are areas that should be built. There are areas also where strict enforcement of the law must be observed. So these are comprehensive but closely related efforts. And national government and local government must work together. National policies are being implemented by the local government, and even at the barangay level, community-based taking care of the environment and preparedness and mitigation are very, very critical.
Last year, Congressman, we have seen some coastal provinces experience flooding, not just for the first time, well, others for the first time. I was thinking if the bill has some provisions that can tackle this. Are we talking about improvements on the technology and personnel training?
Yes, Rica. We said earlier that this bill was consolidated. Originally, this stood up as only one separate bill on coastal greenbelt, but we fought together with the experts and then implementing agencies like the DNR and the NGOs that this should be complemented with the coastal resource management. And when you talk about coastal resource management, coastal management of areas, integrate them, integrated coastal management with the coastal greenbelt, then adoption of technologies that will strengthen and the capacity to enhance the protection of our coastal areas is very, very important. In the same way that we look at mitigation efforts of reducing carbon emissions using new technologies as well, and all the innovations that will help in protecting the coastal communities and the greenbelt areas, as well as the integrated coastal management implementation, will consider also technologies that are new, technologies that are relevant, and that can produce more economic results. At the same time, address climate change. Because many of the technologies that are being used also contribute to global warming. So we have to be very selective and also critical and make sure that our technologies are responsive to the issues that we are raising for the day.
That's nice that you also tackled climate change in the same answer, Congressman. Now, let's look at the conservation efforts of marine life and habitat. We're not talking just about marine life, but also in the local and local flora and fauna. How can this help?
This is very important, Rica, because mainstreaming our ICM, or Integrated Coastal Management, into the national and local government planning. We have planning bodies from national to local, and also integrate with coastal greenbelt. This will provide a lot of support for the disaster risk reduction management, and the action plans on coastal greenbelt also are integrated into the plans for coastal management. So what is very significant about community-based planning and community-based implementation of programs and projects and even monitoring is that they are closer to the people and they are closer to the realities of life and environmental protection. So when communities start being so concerned with their areas, whether you are in the watersheds or you are in the upland areas or in the coastal areas, then it also enhances the capacity of people to respond when there are critical situations. We know that climate change has affected lives of people, not only during disasters, but even agriculture is affected, even health care is affected. So modern technologies are important, and adaptive technologies that can be adapted that will also mitigate these concerns on global warming mm-hmm. is very significant. And science-based decisions have to be put in place as well.
Mm-hmm. We really need some environmental legislation up and running because of the climate change affecting the whole world. With that, I will let you go, Congressman Edgar Chato. Thank you so much for your time, sir, and have a happy weekend ahead of you.
Thank you very much, Rica, and good day, everyone.